The National Union of People's Lawyers of the Philippines will also question the Anti-Terrorism Act of 2020 once it takes effect. The group says it will exhaust all efforts to challenge before the Supreme Court what it describes as a draconian law. The NUPL's President, Attorney Edre Olalia, now joins us on this program for more on this issue. Good morning, Attorney Olalia, and thank you very much for joining us.
Hi, good morning, Christian. Magandang umaga.
Okay, I think a group of lawyers went ahead with the filing of a case before the Supreme Court questioning the allegedly unconstitutional provisions of the new Anti-Terrorism Act of 2020. But in the case of NUPL, why did you decide to wait?
Well, we originally had a 117-page draft petition as early as June 17. And then in the course of time, we revisited what is before us. And then there were many who wanted to join as petitioners. And then we want to tighten the procedural requirements as well as to add more substantive issues so that we can cover all bases. And also, there is this two minds about when is the right time to file the petition. Without making any judgment either way, we think that in abundance of caution, we can wait until the law takes effect on June 18. Since June 18 is Saturday, maybe we can file it on June 20 because we think that it is better to be safe and sure rather than be sweet.
So you mentioned the procedural requirements. How big an issue is that if you file the case before the actual law takes effect on July 18?
Well, there is jurisprudence, although not on all fours, that even before a law takes effect, in fact, even before implementing rules are issued, you can already question them on the basis of imminence of the danger and damage. But there is also jurisprudence to say that the law must be effective to start with. Mm. And the surest way, of course, the question is when there is an actual injury or damage, when someone is arrested, when someone is designated. So we think that it bodes for everybody that many groups, I think these 10 more or less, groups will file petitions at different junctures so that we will really be covering all possibilities.
But in this case, even if you file the case after the law takes effect on July 18, is it also clear that this measure can be subjected to a facial challenge even without an actual injury yet?
Yes, certainly. Even if there is no actual damage or injury or application, a facial challenge is possible. In fact, it is recognized because of certain provisions in the law itself that says that there is a restriction that amounts to a restriction of basic rights to freedom of speech and expression. So you don't need an actual injury or damage before you can have a, what we call a facial challenge. But if there is an injury and hope that there will be none in the next few days, you can also question it by application, so to speak.
Okay, in the case of the NUPL, as far as the NUPL is concerned, what do you find most objectionable and perhaps most blatantly unconstitutional among the provisions of the new anti-terrorism law?
Ang dami. Siguro at least 10, no? But definitely I can easily say 5. 1, the definition. No? 2, the designation of organizations or individuals as terrorists. 3, the preliminary prescription within 72 hours, ex parte. 4, the detention without judicial warrant and 14 to 24 days. 5, the house arrest, where you can be held incommunicado despite filing bail. And this is one provision, Christian, I might point out. No, I stumbled over this. Section 32, subparagraph E. It refers to the logbook, the official logbook. Oh, yeah. On its face, it looks fine. No? But if you check it out, it says there that the logbook must also specify the dates and times where the detained person was removed for interrogation for any purpose.
Okay.
Do you realize the implication of this institutionalization of interrogation being brought out of the cell at any time without any assurance that the lawyer has been notified well beforehand? So in other words, that the lawyer will only know that your client, which is what is happening though, And now, the problem is, it is legitimizing such a practice. In a hostile environment where you are in custody of the security forces and practically incommunicado, because it takes some time before the lawyer or even your family or physician can get to you, if at all, well, those are the times where a lot of violations happen, no? Forced confessions, torture, production of false witnesses, and so on and so forth. So I think this is something that must also be brought out.
Okay. Now, of course, there's also another way of looking at that particular provision. I'm looking at Section 32 now. Of course, that is the fear. That is also very possible, because we know that there are also certain instances or cases where that fear has been materializing also, right? So, but the other perspective is this: by putting that in the law, that can also serve as a safeguard against abuse.
Well, if they do follow the law, but the problem is, the reality is, they don't. Even before the anti-terror law has been signed, we have a wealth of experience being lawyers for several of these clients that is also good on paper, no? I mean to say, they can come up with all sorts of excuses, no? And they can give you the runaround. We've done this in several camps, in several police stations. They give us the runaround. By the time you get to our client, all the wounds and all the bruises have all healed, no? And then they will just say, okay, you just pass it on to the next superior officer until such time that all the rights of your client have already been violated. So I think it's the better way to look at it is not to institutionalize something that is vulnerable to commission of violations. So it should have been better if they should have put there that in any case that the detainee is brought out of the cell for any reason, the lawyer must forthwith instantly be notified, absent which he cannot be brought out of the cell.
Okay, so that is one clarification, because those who are pushing for this law, we're actually arguing that it's better to put something like this to institutionalize the safeguards, because at least you would have something to go by in case abuses happen. But that's your suggestion. If you really want to put this in, there has to be that qualification. The lawyer must be notified.
That is correct, but that is not to concede that this provision will save the whole law. No, in other words, because the law is polluted with so much provisions that a sprinkling or a relish of a certain so-called safeguards will not save it. Why do I say that, Christian? No? In reality, we have Miranda rights. It's in the Constitution, no? The right to remain silent, the counsel. We had the anti-torture law. Mm-hmm. We had the anti-disappearance law. We had the RA 7438, the rights of the accused. No? We have the Karil, as a matter of fact. Mm-hmm. We are signatories maybe to 11 of the 12 international covenants. But why are violations still happening and there is impunity? No one is practically convicted, let alone prosecuted. So what I'm saying is that it's also nice on paper, but laws have context, no? They are not in the abstract, they're not from the sky that falls to the ground. They have context, political, economic, social context, and realities, because they say, oh, every law can be abused. But why do you provide the opportunity for vulnerabilities for abuse, especially when you have experience to look back to, or even facing you right now? And then what I'm saying is that there is no incompatibility with fighting real terrorism and ensuring that the rest of the many, ilan lang ba terorista sa lipunan natin, di ba? 110 million tayo. Aabot ba naman 1 billion yung terorista, yung 20 terorista? Siguro 1,000, 2,000. But the important thing is yung mga inosente. Sasabi niya, eh, huwag kayong matakot. Sana ni General Esperon, vice chair yan ng attack, ha? Siya na mismo nagsabi, mga susuporta daw lang, yung kumabatikos pala ng batas ay malamang supporters ng terrorism. Eh, sabi ko, kung dyan ang logic niyan, eh, di conversely, ibig sabihin, yung mga supporters ng law ay supporters of fascism. It doesn't add up, no? Yeah. So, ang sinasabi natin, look at the law. We read it. We assure you we read it. We have read more laws than we could ever remember. No, this is only a 33-page law with 58 provisions. We've read more. We have analyzed more. So we tell you that this law is very perilous. it is vulnerable to imminent abuse, if not already. We saw in Laguna, the rallies were already packing up, and then they were pounded by the police. Until now, they don't even know what charges to file.
Okay.
We have seen a lot of people being charged with RA 11332, which is totally inapplicable, the mandatory notification of diseases. Totally inapplicable. Ngayon, ito vague na to, broad pa siya, expansive pa siya. Eh di mas lalo tayong madadali dito, yung mga ordinary mga, kahit kayo sa media.
Isn't this safeguard enough? They keep harping on this particular safeguard in terms of the definition of terrorism. It says here, terrorism as defined in this section shall not include advocacy, protest, dissent, or any other similar exercise of civil and political rights.
Yan ang maganda. Ang problema, tumuldok sila dyan. Hindi nila tinuloy yung kolatilya.
Ito yung kasunod. I can read the next part.
Yes, please.
Which are not intended to cause death or serious physical harm to a person, to endanger a person's life, or to create serious risk to public safety. I think that's one of the contentious issues now. What constitutes serious risk? For example,
precisely.
Or a physical
precisely,
harm.
Di ba? Precisely. It is subjective. It is varying. It leaves to the discretion of the police or the military to say or even accuse or even allege. Alam mo, madali lang ha. Madali lang. Mag-a-allege lang sa affidavit of arrest. O kaya sa supporting affidavits ng so-called witnesses. O kaya sa spot report. O kaya kung ano man. This rally or this mass action before the transmitters of ANC, ABS-CBN were intended to cause serious risk to public safety. Tapos tingnan mo ha, endangerment of a person's life. Isang tao lang. Mm. Isang tao lang. So, ibig sabihin, ang daling paikutan. In the meantime, sabi, di ba, ano ka naman eh, ma-acquit ka naman. Ah, mag-itay ka ng 5 to 6 years. In the meantime, kung ang allegation sa'yo of acts of terrorism, life imprisonment, non-bailable. Mm. Di ba? Kung bailable man, kunyari, joining, membership, recruitment, material support, less than life imprisonment, magbe-bail ka, pero yeah, house arrest ka naman. Wala kang cellphone, wala kang laptop, wala kang contact to the outside world, even to your family or outside your residence, just in case they're outside your own residence. So that's the point, no? They keep on harping on this general rule or an exception to the general rule, but the exception to the exception, which brings you back to the general rule, which is terrorism, is either conveniently omitted or are downplayed.
Okay.
Eh, yun ang problema. May konting ano eh, no? may tawag dyan, misleading yan sa legal eh, no?
Uh-oh.
Hindi mo kinukompleto yung citation.
Attorney Lali, I've also spoken with a good number of analysts and they're saying that the real target of this new anti-terrorism law is the CPP-NPA, the communist rebels, and that even legal fronts need to worry about this, including NUPL, for example. How do you react?
Walang question dun sa CPP-NPA. They have already filed a case for prescription still pending before the RTC of Manila. There is also no question because there is a section there that says that those organizations that are listed by the UN are automatically designated as terrorists.
Yeah, precisely.
So, hindi na ano yan. That is a given. No? Ang magiging problema natin yung mga legal organizations, legitimate organizations, or even yung mga non-activist organizations. Nakita mo, Oxfam, pati yung mga humanitarian organizations, di ba, naisama as communist fronts daw. Ngayon, ang problema, hindi lang fronts ang sinasabi, terrorist na. Ay, iba na yan.
Mm.
Kasi, di ba, ang communist party naman, illegal, in theory. Pero kahit na hindi ano yan, ang problema, ay terorista ka. Tingnan mo yung stigma. Kunyari, ikaw, abogado ka, tingin mo yung mga kliyente mo hindi mag-iisip kung kukulin ka pa or kung bibitawan ka. O kaya yung mga sabi-sabi, ay takot, anong pala yan? Yung pera na ginagamit niyan ay galing sa terorismo. Nandiyan na yung mga ill effects. No? So, problema talaga yan kasi sinasabi nila, activism is not terrorism. Sabi din ni Congressman Cayetano, pero sinundan pa niya, huwag niyo itago yung mga terorista sa mga rangko niyo. Eh di ba, nandun na yung mindset. Oh. Si General Esperon, lahat ng nagbumabati ko sa supporters. Ganun din naman kay President, Senate President Vicente Soto. Di ba? Sabi niya, if mapasa ito, hindi na natin kailangan ng martial law. Ang problema dyan, they've already laid the political basis over time, no? As soon as President Duterte came to power, they've already viciously, relentlessly laid the political basis which will be transformed to a legal basis, falsely of course, maliciously of course, that these legitimate organizations are communist fronts, are now terrorists.
Okay.
Nakita na namin yan eh, hawak namin yung kaso ng karapatan, ng Gabriela, kahit kami. Di ba nasama kami sa matrix ni Secretary Panelo, nothing came of it. Because it is fantastic.
Yeah,
it
the bogus matrix.
Oo. Ngayon ang problema, kung nangyari yan after effectivity.
Oo. Now, finally here, how do you think this would affect the effort to encourage more groups, for example, to take part in the actual parliament of government? For example, yung mga party-based organizations are considered progressives, di ba? So they're also among the groups being labeled by certain government officials as being front organizations for the armed component of the communist movement. So somehow, does this set back that effort to encourage at least the legal front to take part in the actual parliament? Because I think the audience should also understand that we don't have the anti-subversion law anymore. But doesn't this new law somehow make that insignificant, the fact that there's no more anti-subversion law? But you already have this. For all intents and purposes, what you hope to achieve there is already achieved here.
But before I let it slide, they are not legal fronts. They are not legal fronts. They are party list groups, constitutionally recognized. As a matter of fact, they are encouraged to participate. Even NGOs are encouraged. It's in the Constitution, the participation of civil society. So definitely it's going to have an impact. No? Definitely. Because may istorbo, no? Babagalan, ma-distract, ano? Tapos ipuprove, ididisprove pa na hindi ka talaga so-called legal front. So it will slow us down. Kahit kami sa inyo, PN, pambira naman. Imbis na yung mga kliyente namin ang inaasikaso namin, yung ina na nanganak na ng sanggol nasa pulungan, na naaantala kami kasi kailangan namin harapin itong pagpapaliwanag, magpapail ng petition, kung may mahuhuli, ganun naman mangyayari. So it will slow us down, no? But we won't be cowed, no? Kasi sana yung mga aktivista diyan, ang katakutan natin Christian, yung mga ordinaryo. Kasi pwedeng sampulan eh. Ang dami na, 'di ba? Yung teacher, 'di ba? Si Masiata 'yon, yung sa Cebu, yung artist. O ngayon yung sa Pride, yung sa Mendola. Mga ordinaryong civil, yung mga nagpo-post sa Facebook. Alam mo, sige nga, wala bang nagtanong sa inyo kahit sa desk nyo, sa newsroom nyo, okay ba 'to? Hindi kaya tayo sasabit dito? More than ever, more often than before, pag-post lang sa Facebook, i-review mo eh, baka sumabit eh. Di ba? Dati, pwede mong ilagay na lang basta, tapos lulunurin na lang yan ng katotohanan, yung mga kasinungalingan nilang moka, kung sino-sino man yan, malulunod yan. Kasi nga, may freedom of expression, di ba? Di ba? May chilling effect na kagad. Kahit naman sa media, may chilling effect na eh. So, ang laki talaga ng pinsala. Kaya hindi wag na lang sasabihin na, mga aktivista lang, mga komunista lang, mga terorista, lahat tayo pwedeng sampulan. Pag ikaw pinag-initan, okay, sabihin, pag pwedeng mangyari siya, pwedeng gawin sa iba din.
Okay. Attorney Edre Olalia, thank you very much for joining us this morning.
Maraming salamat, Christian. Ingat tayo lahat.
Thank you.